South Sudan, which is a new nation, and we got independent in 2011. We are still a young nation, and you have seen what is going around in the world. I just want us to have some brief background about the country, and I work for Reconcile. Reconcile is one of the organizations that was formed by different churches in the country, and the churches came together to us to form one council called South Sudan Council of Churches, and they formed Reconcile to do peace building activities across the country. And despite that, you can see still there are many challenges that are happening in the country.
It's the other way. The other one. The other button. The other one.
So these are the areas where I'm going to share with you briefly. I'm going to talk about who I am, and then the context of my country, and what is the role of the church and Reconcile in promoting peace in the country, and also my personal experience of how I became as one of the peace promoter in my country. Because if you read in my letter, it says once I was a victim, but I'm a survivor, so I had to also help my people to be survivors of what they are going through in. This is my family. I'm married. I have 4 children. They are all by the grace of God. And beside that also, I'm taking care of other 6 children who are orphans and those who lost their parents in war because what is going on in the country. I'm also a social worker. So these children were brought to me because I'm very much attached to the community, and when they lost their parents, they don't know where to go. So the community had to bring these children to me, and by that time of crisis, I don't know where to take them. I have to keep them with me, and up to now, they are staying with me in my house. So I'm taking care of like 10 children in my life, so this is what I'm going through. The map of South Sudan. We are in the middle here. This is the current South Sudan. Before that, we are one country with Sudan. And Sudan was ruled by British back then. So when the British left, the Arab came in and they took over from the British. They are the one ruling South Sudan up to 2011. That's when we got our independence from the north. And in most cases, the north part of Sudan is most of Muslim. They are most of them, the populations are Muslims. And the south part is Christians. Most of them are Christians. So they have been fighting for like more than 25 years of war on religious line between Christians and Muslims. So the south part had to got divided from the north because of the issues of religion. So we got our independence in 2011, and we became a new nation of its own. And beside that also, just after 2 years of independence in 2013, the country also went back for another political conflict that is also going on in the country. And up to now, still the situation is not improving. So this is what the country is going through. And besides that, the diversity of the country, we have 64 different ethnic groups in South Sudan. And these 64 different ethnic groups has different languages, values, and cultures, languages which they cannot understand each other. So we had only one language that unites us, Arabic language, this is where everyone can speak, but besides that also we have our different dialects that we speak. English also happened to be one of the official language we use, because normally English is taught in school. When you go to school, then this is where you learn English. But for those who did not go to school, they don't know how to speak English. That's the challenge there. The lives of people in South Sudan, of them, we have two types of activities that people of South Sudan are doing across the country. We have those who keep animals, like the pastoralists, and these pastoralists normally keep animals like cattle, and these cattle, like thousands of the cattle. So this is one group of what is existing in the country. And then the other group also, they normally live on farming. They do a lot of farming, and these two different groups normally they don't work together, because those who keep animals, they're nomadic, and sometimes they look for pasture to their animals, so they graze their animals in people's farm. At the end, there is conflict between these two different ethnic groups. So this is why we say 64 different ethnic groups, to work with them, it's not an easy task as a peace promoters in the country. So besides that also, the country is divided into different states, but ruled under one central government, which is the president and the vice, and we have 28 states in the country. This is the current map of South Sudan, and these are the different states in the country. And I come from this state, I stayed there in this state, but I'm not originally from this state, I'm from this state. So you can see, we reconcile, and the churches, we work across all these states in South Sudan in promoting peace building activities. We have seen the impact of what has happened in the country in the video, and this is also one of them, the negative impact that has happened in the country. Most people in the country were displaced because of what is going around, the political issues, and besides also the ethnic conflict that is also happening in the country. Many people were killed, and many properties were destroyed. So most of, like more than 3 million people have left the country because of what is going around. And in most cases, women and children are the ones who are displaced. So the men are in the bushes fighting each other because of what they want. We don't know, yeah. And this is one of the refugees, as you've seen. This is how they were received in one of their country, in Uganda. Most of them flew to Uganda, and others to Congo, Kenya, and Sudan also, we have some refugees there. But in most cases, most of the refugees are in Uganda. So this is how they were received and settled in one of the refugees camps in Uganda. This is also another district where also they are receiving refugees. And what is the role of Reconcile? Reconcile is the resource center for civil leadership, and also it has Peace Institute that train different people to be others in the country. So we work together with the church to see how we can promote peace across the country, and also in the refugees camp, because like after the 25 years of war, most people did not have that time to recover from this long period of war. Immediately the country also went off for another civil war, and it's tearing the people all in the country. So it's affecting the lives of people, and that's why you say South Sudan is the poorest country all over the world. It's a new nation. And though it has also resources blessed by God, like oil and minerals, but despite of all this, still the country remains very poor because of other individual interests who want to control the resources. They don't see the importance of the civilians that are existing in that country. We have the initiative of trauma healing because we thought this is one of the areas that most of our people need healing process. If you examine their stay, their behaviors, their attitude, they only know violence. They only embrace violence to solve issues. So we say people should be taken through trauma healing processes. And this is one of the initiatives we are doing in the country and also in the refugees camp. Besides those who left the country, still we have some people who did not leave the country, but they are displaced, they are internally displaced. They left their homes and they had to come to one center in the city because of what is going around in the country, the fighting. So these displaced people, mostly they come and take refuge in the churches. They stay in the churches and most of them are women who take shelter in the church. They sleep in the church, so the church leaders are the ones taking care of them and also reconcile, also do the same to take care of these people. And we find that it's very difficult for this population to exist in the church because the church cannot feed them all. There are a lot of challenges. The church cannot provide other services to them. Most of them have left their things in their homes, but they are just in the church to take refuge because of what is going on in the country. So in most cases, these women, as you have seen in the video, some of them have experienced terrible things, like seeing their dear ones being killed, even the children seeing their parents being killed, and even women are being sexually harassed. So these are all terrible things. And when they reach to the church, some of them are committing suicide in the church. So we have to come in to help them in awareing them about issues that are affecting them. Because since then, people did not have a safe space for them to discuss about what's happening in their life, like the pain they have gone through. So the church happened to be the only safe space for them to discuss about what is going around in their life. We also find another, when we normally organize like for awareness activities, teaching people about trauma, what is happening in their life, though we organize for like group of 35, sometimes we find people respond more than what we expect. More than 8 days or 7 days, they come to attend because they feel this is the only forum for them to discuss about what's happening in the country. And because also they feel that it's a safe space, they should come and discuss. So we find this a big challenge for us to manage such group in the same time. So what we have to do to divide them in a group of where we can manage to talk to them. Besides that, also across Uganda in the refugees camp, we find a lot of issues that are affecting the refugees in the settlement because these refugees came with different attitude and hatred from their country, besides their ethnicity, there are different tribes. And so reaching to the refugees camp, though they were given information about how to stay together, still they go ahead fighting each other in water points, places, social places, even killing each other. So we are called in by the government of Uganda and also the church that we should come and do a lot of conflict transformation activities in the camps so that these people can coexist together. And this is one of the things we do because we have few of us who are doing this activity. We had to train some caregivers to help the refugees in the settlement. And this is what we are doing This is one of the group of caregivers. We trained in one of the refugee settlements in Uganda to help our refugees who are staying in Uganda. This is the life of children in South Sudan. Since most of the children did not know what is happening around the world, they didn't experience anything about peace. What they know is language of violence, playing of violence, doing any other thing that in regards to violence. They thought this is the life of human being in the world. They did not experience any peaceful environment, most of them. So you can see the way they play, the way they talk to each other is much of violence. So this is a very sad thing that we feel that we need to transform this attitude of violence from this young generation so that tomorrow we shall have a country that is free of violence. This is one of the activities I normally do when I come to these settlements in the refugees camp, because these children were taught by their parents not to love each other. They were even dividing among themselves not to play, because you're from this group, you're from this tribe, so we don't meet with you. So I had to come in to bring different children from different ethnic groups and have sessions with them, talk to them, teach them about to love each other rather than hating. So they share a lot of experience that they were told that these are their enemies, they are not supposed to be together. So we have to transform this thinking from these children, and it's helping a lot. So we are using them also to carry the message to their family about living together as brothers and sisters. Also, we went ahead because the refugees camp is so big and people were many, we cannot manage. We also went to another site of the camp to train some peer counselors and peer educators to go ahead and also teach people in regards to conflict transformation and also trauma healing activities. And these are the groups where we train for 9 months and provide some transport so that they move around the settlement to help people who are in need. Because in the camp, the rate of suicide is also very high, since the women are the ones taking responsibility in their families. It's a challenge for them to manage when their husbands are not there. So these people are just trained to help them to see how they can live in the settlement. This is another group also, the same peer counselors that we have trained. And besides that also, we do a lot of conflict transformation activities, like training women, because we know that most of the families, women are the custodians of the family, and they are the ones doing a lot in the family. So we feel that if we train them on issues of conflict transformation, they will start practicing that in their family with their children, and gradually things will go out slowly. Yeah. And this is one of the beneficiaries that we have trained her on this issue of corporate transformation, and she's also trained other women on our behalf to how to transform conflict peaceful, not really through violence. Yeah. Besides that also, especially the youth, most of the population of people in South Sudan are not educated because of what has been going through for many years in the country, and most of the youth are not educated. Those who has the chance are those who came out from the country for refuge. They will get education that time. But if you did not leave the country, you will not get any education, you will just remain. So we had to develop another strategy on how we can teach these people who are not educated. We normally do through role plays, theaters, for them to participate in conflict sensitivity, in analyzing issues that are affecting. And this is one of the activities we do with youth to train them on conflict analysis and how they can manage conflict peacefully. This is another forum also of conflict analysis, and beside that also we do a lot of reconciliation, dialogue and reconciliation, and this normally happens after taking the group through trauma healing process before we reach to reconciliation, because it's very difficult for you to reconcile someone that is still having that pain, the wound is still there. It will not be easy. So the first thing, we have to take them through healing process until they reach to the reconciliation time. That's when they will reconcile. This is one of the community in one of the states in the country. This community happened to be fighting each other. They do a lot of cattle raiding. They go and grab cattle from another community. They fight and kill each other with guns, and then they raid a lot of cattle. So the church had to call us in, reconcile, to come and do this process of reconciliation in that community. So we are there then for 1 month, doing a lot of healing process through. And at the end, this is the last day where the two communities have to come together to reconcile and they accept to live peaceful among themselves. And they also came with some resolutions of how they can maintain their peace. So they have to sign, each party, including women, they have to sign that this agreement we are not going to break and we are going to maintain it. And this is working, and up to now, that community is living peaceful without any issue of raiding and fighting each other. Also, this is one of the issues that we also find is a challenge. When the refugees were brought to Uganda, some of them even reached the extent of fighting the host community that are hosting them. People who gave them the place where they can be settled. So these host communities have a lot of challenges with the refugees. They don't share resources together. They fight, like when the refugees are going to collect firewood, some of them were killed in the bush. So we were called to come and talk to them. And this is one of the dialogue we had with the different leaders of that particular community on issues, how they can coexist together with the refugees. And we find it also helpful because we had some projects that they were working together with the refugees women, and this is one of the point where they were living well and the relationship were improved. This is also one of the forum we had with another community, the different camp. Besides that also, we do a lot of interfaith dialogue. Though South Sudan is 90% Christian, but we have also some Muslims, like 10% of the population are Muslim. So these 10% of Muslims, they feel marginalized. They feel that their voices are not heard in the community. So we have to develop another way of dialoguing together, bringing these Muslims and different religions together to discuss issues of how we can work together to serve the country. And this is what we do, and they also have a role to play in promoting peace in the country. This is also one of the forums we had with church leaders. As I say, most of the churches were hosting displaced, internal displaced people who left their homes and they are staying in the church. So these leaders normally faced a lot of burden because most of the people are running to them for help, and also they cannot provide that help because they don't have what they can give. So sometimes they find it difficult to live even in the church because of the need. You see your people are in great need and you cannot provide. Sometimes they have that feeling of breaking down because of what is going around in the country. So what we had to do, we had to create a retreat week for them. Like in a month, we have 5 days where we sit together with the pastors in different churches to talk about their workload, about how they can offload their workload, and then how they can also be sincere about what they have for them, what they don't have, so for them to have effective services in their community. And normally we find it very useful. Sometimes we come and we talk. When they go back, they renew again, and they will give effective services to their people. We did not also add only at the grassroots level. We have also people who represent the government in the country. We normally channel our voices to them because we are like the middleman between the grassroots and the upper side. Most of the issues that are happening at the grassroots level, the government doesn't know what is going on. So for us who are very much attached to the grassroots level, we normally have enough information to talk on behalf of the people who are suffering and to tell the government what to do. Table everything to them and to discuss how we can resolve this issue peacefully. And this is one of the forums we had with different government officials on issues that are affecting our people. We also came with another new strategy. We call it quiet diplomacy, because where we live, the issue of different forces fighting around the country. So people, most of the people are staying in the city, so you cannot move outside to do your farming and to do other activities. So those who were displaced from their areas and they are taking refuge in the church, the church cannot provide food for them all the time. And these people have their farms outside, they have enough food in their farms. So we had to talk to these different forces that are doing these activities, that are killing people, on behalf of the people to believe so that they will go and collect food for their families so that they will come and sustain themselves. And this is one of the things which we do. We go to the bush together with the church and talk to the different militias groups that are fighting each other to allow these civilians to go and access their food, because these civilians, they are not enemies. They don't have anything to defend themselves. So we talk to them and talk to the government, and they have that respect to the church and us, and normally they allow the civilians to go and collect food for themselves, and it's working, because right now, in the country where I'm living, especially in the state, we don't have any support or even humanitarian bodies who are helping these people. It's only the church and us because of the insecurity that is happening around the country. This is also one of the locations where we talk to different forces in the bush to allow our civilians to access their food, and normally they accept that they will select 2 days in the week for you to come collect your food and come home. This is what is happening. And this is how we sustain them in the country. And this is how the country, in some of the parts, are still remaining calm because of what we have been doing throughout. These are some of the humanitarian people who were sent by different agencies to come in the state where I'm living so that they will provide services, social services to people. But on their way, all of them were arrested and hosted like for 1 month in the bush. So the church and us reconciled had to come in to talk to these different forces to release these humanitarian workers. And when this is the day when they are released, since that time, that's the end of humanitarian workers in that particular city. So all of them were evacuated. So there are no more humanitarian workers who are working in the city. Besides that, also we thought of not only going the soft way, but also we need to do some empowerment, especially with the women who are taking responsibility in their families. And in most cases, we do this one in the refugees camp, and the support is from the BCUSA, and we are very grateful for that. This is one of the projects we feel that we can not only work with the refugees, but also we want to involve the host community that are hosting the refugees to also participate in this project of goats rearing together with the women. And we find it one of the areas where they strengthen their relationship with the refugees. So this is one of the group from the host community that are hosting the refugees. And this is the group of women in the refugees camp. They work together with the host community in rearing this animal that they use to support their family. And since then, the relationship between the host and the refugees is doing well. They are sharing resources together, and they also work together, solving issues together. Yeah. Also, we did not end there. We find that youth, most of the youth are idle in the refugees camp. The only thing they do, drugs and other terrible things that is not useful to their health. So we have to come with this project of bricks laying. They lay bricks and then they sell to support themselves. And this is how we keep them busy in the refugee settlement, where they lay bricks, they sell and to help themselves, because some of them are staying idle without doing anything. And when they stay idle, they become very dangerous to the community. Yeah. So we also do a lot of advocacy beside that. We talk to different forces, different people around the world, and also to our government concerning the issues that are affecting people and the process of peace, how they can resolve this conflict in their country. So this year we also came with another strategy because since 2016, people were just going to their farm and collect food. They don't farm. So what they had in the farms are already finished. So this year we had to also come with another initiative that we need to talk to the different forces, including the government, to give space like 5 miles from the town for different civilians to go and access so that they do farming for themselves. And this is one of the dialogue we had with some government leaders and different forces, that how they can allow these people to go and do farming for themselves. And this year, this is where now most of the people are allowed to go and do farming for themselves, so that this is the only way we can sustain them in the country. This is my personal experience. I normally come to a refugees camp. I stay with people and talk to them. Like this woman, she happened to be one of the victims. Her son and the daughter-in-law was shot when she was there. And this boy was left when she was 5 months old in 2016. So this woman had to come to me, and she wanted me to take this care of this boy. I told her I cannot do because I had other 6 of them. This is already bad. So I had to empower her and encourage her to take care of this baby, because she's still strong. And also beside that, I do a lot of advocacy for her so that she can get support to raise this boy. And this is now the boy. She is working, he's growing. Without word for that. And whenever I come to the camp, I normally visit her, stay with her in her house. Yeah, this is what we do. Well, beside that, also visiting other women, family visit. I do a lot of family visit, and to encourage most of them, because of their women, to encourage them how to take care of their families and children, and to raise these children despite that their husbands are not there. This is one of the home mission workers that was sent to South Sudan, By then, and because of the crisis, she was with her family. They were taking, they shifted to Uganda, and they are staying in Uganda. But recently, they came back to US. So this family, she's called Nancy. Her husband's called Shepish Smithman. We work together with them. Normally, when we come to the refugees camp to Uganda, we go together in the refugees camp and visit, to visit our different people and to talk to them. And they've been so of help to us and our strength also, because they encourage us to work very hard. This is one of the military exercises we do in the refugees camp for those whom we have trained. And this is one of the trauma healing activities normally we do with group of children of different age. And this is the last stage where they had to show their sign of hope, showing their flowers after being taken through stages of healing and have realized that they are now well. Yeah. These are some of the challenges the country is facing. As I say, high rate of illiteracy is very high, and we know that education is the key, and when people are not educated, they don't know what they are doing. So we find that this is a challenge still in the country, that the issue of inter-ethnic conflict and some tensions are still there, because 64 different ethnic groups to manage them is not an easy thing, it's a journey. So this is what we are facing. And some economic crisis also still, the country is not stable because of what is going around, and the war continues tearing the country up. And this is how the road where we live. Though we have some well-wishers who want to help us, still access to road is a challenge. So we find it is a challenge to us. And besides that also we find across the country, youth across the country have limited opportunity for education and some employment. So as that, most of them were driven by the different forces to join the force. Maybe you'll tell them, join the force, I will pay this amount of money. You find young people, age of 12, ahead joining these different forces, and most of them are the ones who have been killed in the process. So we find it is very, very difficult how we can rescue the future of that country. And we are working hard, advocating on behalf of these young people not to join these different forces, because they don't know what is going around. They don't understand the interests of these individuals who are getting them in this mess. So this is how we normally face in the country. Thank you. If you have some questions for me, I also, my personal experience, like I'm once, as I say, a victim and now a survivor, because I was born in the war and grew in the war, giving birth to children in the war. So it's not an easy task. One time I happened to be like this girl that you've seen in the movie. When I was 5 years, people were running all over, shooting in the city. I had to run after a different family. So I was with that family for some time, and I failed to locate my family. And this is where I lost my father. I didn't know when I was 5 years. So from that time, this is how I figured I need to make a U-turn to change this cycle of violence in my community. I don't want to come for refuge, but to work hard to lay a foundation for the generation that are coming and to encourage others to go to school. Thank you.
I just want to emphasize what you shared. At 5 years old, having to flee for your life, being separated from your family for 2 years, and process having lost your father to violence, really not knowing a time in your country where there was not civil war, in realizing that dislocated population of South Sudan rivals the population of the state of Kentucky. And there really is no promise and insight in this moment, because two leaders are currently using many people in their country for pawns and battling over personal power. It's a huge wound going on in our world right now. And I hope that today that you learn something about South Sudan. Some of you may have some questions. I'm going to invite you to ask them one-on-one. I know some people have to raise off of their class, so they're going to dismiss you. But if you have personal questions, why don't you come down here and talk to Lucy. Again, thank you so much for being with us.